I've now had my 1320 for over a year, and I've been meaning to do a one-year review for quite a while, but things kind of got in the way, and I couldn't get around to it. Plus, I wasn't sure exactly what to do or how to go about it, because if you've watched my videos, I've documented everything. I've shown you everything. I've talked about everything. Everybody already knows everything about this car. You all know I love it. You all know I would get it again. I would never get rid of it. You know what problems I've had, which really are none at all, other than like a rock chip. Obviously, I have no control over. There's some bad shifting issues, but that was actually in year two, not year one. So we'll not talk about that now. Well, you already know about it. So if I was to do a review, that was pretty much it. Pretty short, isn't it? Can't do a video like that. So I was thinking, how can I make it different? What can I do? And a question that comes up a lot with cars is, how much do you pay for? How much does it cost you? How much you pay in gas? How much for mods? How much for this? How much for that? So that's what this video is going to be. I am going to do a full rundown of every cost I incurred because of owning this car for the first year. And at the end of the video, I'm going to sum it all up and give you the final number of what this car cost me in 1 year of ownership. Now, all the numbers I'm going to talk about in this video, they start from delivery day, June 22nd, 2020, and stop at the 1 year mark on June 22nd, 2021. Now, some of the numbers like mileage might be a little bit low considering this is my daily driver, but as we all know, it hasn't really been a normal world, especially in 2020. And because of that, I worked mostly from home and didn't really have to drive it all that much. Now, year two, we'll definitely be seeing a lot more though. But also keep in mind, we've had some pretty significant inflation recently. So some of the prices I talk about in this video are not even gonna be relevant anymore. Prices have gone quite a bit up. All right, so with all that out of the way, let's go ahead and get started. And where do we start? Well, same place we always start, the finance office of the dealership. And that is our first number, which is $46,507. That is the MSRP on the window sticker. Now, of course, I didn't pay that. I got rebates of $5,850 plus a deal at 1% below invoice. So my price on the car was actually $38,298. Now, hard to believe considering the current state of the market and what cars are selling for nowadays, not to mention the base scat price has gone up significantly. Now, add in tax, title, and license for Texas, and I walked out the door for $40,877.24. Although I actually did spend another $70.50 a few months later when I got a personalized Air Force plate. Now, talking about the crazy market is today, back in July, right after I hit the 1 year mark, I decided to go check on Vroom and see what they would offer me for my car. At that time, prices were already going up. People were getting some good numbers. So I was like, hey, why not? Let's just see what it is. You wouldn't believe this. I kind of don't believe it. But Vroom offered me $46,537. Yeah, that's not just more than I paid out the door, but more than the MSRP. I mean, had I taken that deal, I would have pocketed over $10,000 after paying off my loan, of course. But like I said, this car ain't going nowhere. It's with me for life. Now, you might ask, how would I have pocketed over $10,000? Well, let's go back to that finance office because I didn't pay cash up front for this car. I financed it. Now, I did put a $500 deposit when I ordered the car, and then I put down another $1,000 the day of delivery. Now I add in the monthly payments that I made in the first year, and we get a total of $7,780 that I paid towards this car. That brought my principal balance down to $35,714.15. I know if you're doing the math, I didn't exactly get the best interest rate that day in the finance office, but I have refinanced it since then, so I'm paying a little bit less now. And just FYI, my monthly payments are $675.29. Although I actually just pay $700 a month. I like even numbers, and that just puts a little bit extra so that, you know, I'll pay it off a little bit sooner. Oh yeah, and I did actually get $40 of all that back. How? Well, sold them bananas on eBay. Now, owning a car is obviously more than just paying for it. You need insurance too, at least if you want to be on the road legally. Now, it's a little bit trickier number for me to get exactly, because if you've seen my other videos, you've watched my channel, you know I also have a 2017 Ram truck and a travel trailer. both of which obviously have to be insured too, and therefore they're on the same policy with the 1320. So total, I'm paying $230 a month for all three, for the vehicles and a trailer. But based on some calculations, because I can't split out the full coverage, comprehensive collision on the car, liability gets mixed between all of them. But it works out that this car is about $100 per month. So let's just say insurance cost me $1,200 for the first year. All right, now that we're insured, let's get out of the finance office, hit the road. Now, working from home, that didn't happen very often. And I actually only put 2,231 miles on the odometer in the first year. But this thing isn't battery powered. It's 392 cubic inches of air breathing gas guzzling American muscle. And in this first year, she drank 146.514 gallons of 93 octane fuel. Well, almost all 93 octane. 9.16 of those gallons were actually only 91, because Oklahoma, if you're from there, you know a lot of gas stations don't have anything more than 91. And another 8 of those gallons were actually already in the car from the factory, so I can't say for sure what kind they use there. You would hope that Dodge would use a premium since that's what they recommended it, but you never know. So in total, all that fuel cost me $370.57, gives us an average price per gallon of $2.67. Yeah, that tells you how bad inflation has gone up. We're definitely not seeing anywhere near that today. So year two is definitely going to be a lot higher. But having all those numbers, we can calculate my actual mileage. And in the first year, we saw 15.227 miles per gallon, which, to be honest, kind of surprises me because of the way that I drive and the fact that I never allow MDS to get enabled, and I'm racing a lot. So 15.227, that's pretty good. Now, keeping a car on the road obviously takes more than just fuel. You've got to keep it in tip-top shape, and that means maintenance. And because of the way I drive, along with all the racing, not to mention the manufacturer recommended intervals, I did do 2 oil changes within the first year, and those oil changes cost me $187.08, and that's for 18 quarts of oil and 3 oil filters. I know, I said 2 changes, but I got 3 filters and more quarts I needed. Well, I got a good deal on a filter, so I picked up an extra one, and this thing takes 7 quarts of oil, and I buy them in cases of 6, so I bought an extra case to start with that fills in that gap. Now, while we're talking about oil, I might as well talk about one of my first mods that I did, and that was installing a UPR oil catch can, and that cost me $137.68, plus another $33.51 for my can and oil breather and the parts I needed to get that done. And that oil catch can, by the way, through the first 2 oil change, caught 32 milliliters of oil total. I know it doesn't sound like much, but that's actually only within 1,692 miles, because that's the mileage at the time of the last oil change of the first year. And then finally, I also picked up a magnetic oil drain plug for $24.88, although that didn't get installed until my third oil change. That will be in my year two video. Now, besides oil, the other maintenance items is tires. Now, normally on a brand new car of such low mileage, we wouldn't even be talking tires, but this thing came with drag radials on all 4 corners, and there's no point to having drag radials on the front. So I replaced those with a pair of Nitto 555 G2s at a cost of $570.82. And of course, I kept the original drag radials on the front because I will then put them on the rear as soon as I burn through the original ones on the rear. In fact, that's what's up there in those plastic bags. Now, we can't stop talking about tires though, because that is just what we use on the street. Obviously, I do a lot of racing and I need tires for that too. Now, I have raced on the stock tires, but I wanted a dedicated set, something lighter and faster and better. But I didn't just want a little lighter, a little better. I wanted the lightest and the best, or as close as I could get. So for the rear, I got 17x10 Billet Specialties Windlight single bead locks. And to get those to fit properly, I needed a pair of B-Woody shortened end links. Now, luckily, there was another 1320 owner local to me who had just done a rear 15-inch brake conversion, and he just happened to have the exact rear setup that I needed, and he sold them to me for $1,700. So that saved me a little bit of money over buying those rears for new. Now, I still need to wrap them in some rubber, though, because they didn't come with tires, and I want the tried and true 305 4517 Mickey Thompson ET Street R's that cost me another $710.10. Now for the front, I got 17x4.5 wind lights costing $1,024.23. Wrapped those in some Hoosier Bias ply tires for another $365.04. Finally, add in another $145.46 for hub-centric rings, mag-shank lugs, mounting the front tires, balancing all 4, all those little added costs. Now, since we're already on topic of mods, we may as well just keep going. And I'm going to go over these in generally the order I got them. So first up, we got some stuff from Lux, including door handle cup paint production film, side marker light tints, tail light divider decal. And that all totaled $85.57. Although I haven't even installed the rear tail light divider yet. And the next thing I got was the Mopar TACAI, and that was $647.70. But I did use an AFE headlight tube with it, and I heat wrapped the system. So that added another $103.54. And I know it's a pretty crazy price for a CI that a lot of people say doesn't even do anything, but I had to have a truly functional scoop because that's just me. Now going to the opposite end of this glorified air pump, we have the exhaust. Now my exhaust is still stock with one exception. I wanted to keep the active exhaust fully open all the time, so I did get the Z Automotive inactive exhaust plugs for $179.05. Now I know I didn't really need them because I could have done a free option. I showed it worked. I tried it on this before I installed it. I did them on Buddy's car. But I wanted to be able to remove the actuators completely as well as the valves themselves one day down the road. And so that's why I went with the plugs. So now the next mods go into what I'm known for, which is weight reduction. And we're going to start the very front, and that is the SpeedLogic's lightweight front bumper support. Now I tried to get them to sponsor it for me, but they flat out ignore me. So I did have to pay $291.99 for it. Although, funny enough, they didn't ignore my install video because they posted it on their site right on their product page. Now, inside the car, we obviously have the seats. For the driver's seat, I installed a lightweight Kirky racing seat, and that required a Planet Technology base, brackets, hardware, seat cover, universal belt buckle. All that stuff added up to $597.96. Now, the rest of the seats, I just flat out removed. But, of course, that left the seat airbag plugs exposed, causing the airbag system to be disabled, along with that warning light. But luckily, there is a demon owner on Facebook that makes dummy plugs to take care of those. But they're not cheap either. It cost me $344 for both the driver and passenger side plugs, but worth it. He uses OEM parts, too. And while we're on topic of plugs and warning lights, I did also remove the windshield washer reservoir, which caused a low fluid light. But for another $427, I got a plug for that from that same guy for the seatbelt plugs. Now, with all the weight reduction on the inside of the car, I didn't want to just leave it all exposed. So I did get the windows tinted for $275. That way, at least my car looks normal from the outside. I also did get a windshield sunshade so that when it's parked in the harsh Texas sun, it'll protect the dash that I do have left. And that shade only cost me $25.36 since I kind of had an Amazon gift card available for the remainder. Now, because this is a 1320, and one of the reasons I got it is because it was my way to get back on a drag strip. Now, to do that though, there's safety gear and some track essentials that you need, like a helmet, race jacket. I got racing shoes, a gas can, Dowlin marker, and all that stuff added up to $603.66. And then for the times I can't get to a drag strip, I did also pick up a draggy and a P gear for another $283 total. Now, when we go to the drag strip, we can't exactly show up with a dirty car. So I did have to buy a bunch of cleaning supplies, and this car is kind of special. So it needed a little bit more than just your everyday garden hose. So I did pick up an electric pressure washer. That way I can use a Chemical Guys foam cannon. And I need obviously soap, wash mitts, microfiber towels, a mini blower to help dry it off. Stuff that I didn't have because I didn't need it for my Avenger. And honestly, my Ram doesn't need it either. And all that stuff came out to $396.35. Now talking about supplies, doing all my own maintenance and work, there's other tools and equipment needed, things I need to outfit my garage with, stuff that I didn't need or don't need for my truck or my previous car. That included race ramps, wheel chocks, creeper, low profile jack pads, some lights, oil change supplies, some specific tools again that I didn't need for any of the other stuff I did because my Ram is mostly stock and so is my previous car. In all, that came out to another $698.03. Now, in the first year, like I said at the beginning of this video, I didn't have any breakages or repairs except for the one rock chip on the windshield, and I did end up taking care of that myself, and it cost me $17.31 for the repair kit. You might think we've got to be wrapping this up soon, but we're not. There's still more. There's still a few small mods that I bought but haven't actually installed yet, like a 180-degree thermostat, smooth intake coupler, tint spray, can of Royal Purple octane booster. Those few minor things add up to another $116.10, and there's reasons I haven't installed those, although I did use the octane booster recently. Now, if it wasn't obvious, I love data, especially about my car. So in the beginning, when I first got it, I did pay $12 to get it weighed, put on a CAT scale, And then I paid out another $25 to get the config tree that shows this car is a one of one as configured. Not that that means anything, but hey, it's cool to know. Back to about mods though. Unfortunately, not all of them went exactly as planned, as you've seen in some of my vids. Some of these mistakes, or you know, I call them lessons learned the hard way, cost me money. There was the wrong front skinny wheels that I got that you saw in the vid that didn't really fit, but I tried to make them work and in the end got something else. There's also my seat. I did get a Brom seat originally that I ended up not using and going with Kirky instead. And then things like also when I did the active exhaust, I got a delete kit from Chaos Motorsports I didn't use, although I did end up giving that away. Now the problem with a couple of these mods, like the wheels and the seat, it took me so long to get to the install that by the time I figured out I wasn't going to use them or they didn't fit, it was way past the return window. But I was able to sell them. So I was able to get some of my money back, but for anyone that's tried selling their things, you never get 100% of your money back that you paid for an item. And with the front wheels, I had them listed for so long, it just needed the right person, I needed money, so I let them go a little bit cheaper. So in total, for all the stuff that was wrong, I paid $2,083.69, and I was only able to sell it all for $1,090.84. That's after shipping and fees, because a couple things were on eBay. So that leaves me with a loss of $992.85. It's something I incurred, so we have to add it to the total. Okay, now I promise I'm getting towards the end here. We're almost done. There's one more thing I need to add that this car has cost me. And that is, we talked about the drag strip, and going to drag strip is not free. There's entrance fees, tech cards, trailer rental for when I towed it, hotel stays for those out-of-town races. And in the first year, we've had some test and tunes, Lone Star Mopar Fest in Houston, Big Showdown YouTuber call out, Southern Plains Mopar Fest in Oklahoma City. And all those races, between all the fees, costs, trailers, hotel stays, added up to $1,072.28. And with that, we can finally wrap this up and get to our big number reveal. Now, before I do that, though, I do want to explain some, because I keep talking about these are all the costs that this car has cost me that I incurred. And obviously, I would have had some costs anyway, because I need a car, I need to get around. But before I got this car, my daily was a 2012 Dodge Avenger RT, a car that was 100% paid for, unmodded, other than the CAI I got a long time ago. And it was just simply reliable transportation. I didn't race it, didn't go to the drag strip with it, none of that. Had I not gotten this 1320, I never would have gone to the drag strip, never would have got all the equipment I need, the supplies that I got, never would have had a monthly payment, would have paid a lot less in insurance, maintenance, gas costs, because a lot of those 2,000 plus miles weren't necessary. Had I had the Avenger, I would have put on probably less than 1,000 miles in that first year. And knowing that makes this final number a little shocking to the system. Now, you might also say, had it not been for this car, I wouldn't have a YouTube channel. You are correct. However, I did not get monetized until just a couple months ago. So in the first year that we're talking about right now, all my YouTube channel, all the videos I put out didn't earn me a single penny. In fact, it cost me. It takes a lot of time creating and editing videos. But we're not going to include that. We're just saying we didn't make any money from it. And so, the moment we've all been waiting for. In the first year of ownership of this 2020 Dodge Challenger 1320, stretching from June 22nd, 2020 up to June 22nd, 2021, this car has set me back a grand total of $21,073.62. That's right, over $21,000. And I have a car that I still owe the bank over $35,000 for at the end of that first year. But you know, that's how it goes. We all know the answer to the question, how fast you want to go? It's how much money you got. Fast ain't cheap, racing ain't cheap. So if you want a car to get into racing, there's some of your costs. And I didn't even get any crazy mods. Now, luckily, a lot of these costs, some of the equipment, things like that, are up front. I'm not gonna have to buy them again. But year two, we are gonna see more driving, more races. So are we gonna pay more over the second year, less? I don't know. Subscribe, follow along, because next year I'm gonna do the same thing. And I'm going to add up the total life of the car. And we're going to keep doing this constantly. We're going to see how much this Challenger costs me for as long as I have it, which is going to be, again, decades. So if you liked the video, found any of the info useful, don't forget, hit that like button. Don't forget to subscribe. And with that, thank you for watching. I'll see you at the drag strip.